like I said before, we have our father in the Lord, Bishop Osai, the senior pastor and the general overseer of City of Refuge. Now, you'll be amazed because you'll be blessed this afternoon. Welcome, sir.
Thank you very much.
We want to quickly ask you some questions about the City of Refuge.
Okay.
City of Refuge is a very, very big church. Very big church.
Right.
When I said big church, I mean big church.
Right.
Big church. Yeah. Okay, sir. So what year did you get a vision about City of Refuge? Have you ever served under a pastor before God gave you that calling? Or God just gave you the calling to open the church?
Well, I have served. I served Pastor I.S. James of Gloryland. Was his driver.
Wow. Mm. Wow.
After graduating from the university.
Oh.
And he was my mate. We left university the same year. You know, these days everybody's a big man.
Mm.
I served Pastor Taiwo Dina, Church of God Mission, Jos, 1985.
Oh.
Over Commerce Faith Center. Okay, Panam and I worked together when Panam was doing Footsteps Foundations. And just then in Lagos, and I served him.
Oh.
He repented with my presence, and I served him. Then, Osmanse Madubuku, I wouldn't say I served him that much, but I was a part of the Foundation of Rabbah Assembly. And then I became a full fledged pastor for Duncan Williams. I was Action Faith Lagos. Christian Action Faith Ministry Lagos. Then Paul was in the UK, Paul of House of Rock. So we were, as it were, colleagues serving under Duncan Williams, going for pastors meeting in Ghana, prayer meetings and all that. It was in the process of that service that the Lord spoke to me one day and told me it was time to move on. I didn't know what moving on meant, really. So I went to Ghana with my wife and said, Bishop, sir, this is what I'm hearing. I have a bond with my Bishop, Nick Duncan Williams. Yeah, he's a good man. He has a good heart. He's a good man. So anytime, he calls me Odifo. Odifo is prophet. So once he sees Odifo, what's God saying? I told him this is what I'm hearing, but I don't know what it means. He said, okay, I should take time and pray. I came back. After 6 months, we went back. He said, okay. He doesn't actually really want to continue with the Nigerian church. That what he's saying in Nigeria is not happy about. So I still have the certificate of Christian Action Faith Ministry in Nigeria. That's Action Faith. So I was a pastor there for about 4 or 5 years. And then we started City of Refuge on the 1st of June, 1996. Well, we have seen a little growth. We have seen challenges. 3 times they demolished our church. And our church has been a church on Exodus.
Mm.
As it were, traveling from Egypt to the Promised Land. This church has been at Jawa Estate, has been behind Alade Market, has been in Ogudu Are, has been in Ogudu Road, Ogudu Road,
yeah.
Has been at, incidentally, the first site of that church was called Gilgal. Yes.
Whoa.
Gilgal, the blue roof, yes. On the, Jesus. You know when you're coming from Alakwere to Ogudu?
Yeah.
That bush by the right, I cleared that bush with bulldozer 21 days with 3,000 lorry loads of sand on ground at 9,000 per lorry load. Then we brought electricity from Alakwere in there. I remember one boy who was one of my boys told me he wants to go and stay in there. I said, no, it's too dangerous because that express and robbery there is heavy. I said, don't worry. So what I did was I went and brought all my gadget, my clothes for traveling to America, all those big overall against him. He was there when the Anandar Oba came, fully armed. He said he saw only one. The man kicked him. He said, "What are you doing here?" He said, "This is our church." Anandar Oba looked at him, carrying his gun. He said, "Church, now you day here." I said, "Yes." Oba did like this. I was just around. The boys went back to lying down. The Anandar Oba went back. All those armed robbers I used to live under that bridge. It was when we cleared that place, electrified the whole place. That's what drove them away from there. I used to go for prayer meeting in that Gilgal every 6 a.m. from Ogudu. With my BMW, I used to drive a BMW, flashy green BMW. If I one day one policeman stopped me saying, "Should we say we pastor?" See the car where they drive, say they go. Prayer in the morning. For the 3-4 years we stayed there, nobody attacked me. To serve God is something else.
Yeah.
Never seen an armed robber. Nobody asked me, "This car you're driving?" Every morning. The 21 days of bulldozer clearing there, I used to sit down there. In fact, if you see some of the pictures, I wear my white kaftan. Sit there. What I'm saying in effect is that I have a long history, really. Some people have the experience where nothing happened, you just start church, you began to grow, no, that's not what it is. And God, my experience, God doesn't give me rich people to start with, no. Mm. It's just what, as we keep growing, you see people, by the ministry of the Word of God, the Word of God has power.
Mm.
The Word of God blesses.
Yes.
The Word of God opens strange doors.
That's
okay. Typical example. Advanced Motors Bonded Terminal is in Ojo Cantonment. Go there. Ask for them. They tell you I want to see you. I was eating in their house. Eating. The next thing I hear is, "Go and start the dry terminal." I said to man that God says you should go and start the dry terminal. He jumped and said, "How can he talk that nonsense? You know these guys that came from America." His wife said to him, "Shut up." He said, "I didn't do that, talk that nonsense. That, do you know what it takes to start Bonded Terminal?" I said, "Well, this is what I heard." His wife said, "Bishop, did you say God told you? Don't mind my younger husband. He's an unbeliever." This Bongwon Josh, who was director of customs, used to go to their house in Atlanta and buy vehicles and sent to Nigeria. The next thing that happened was that he told them, "I'll give you, though we no longer give this license, but I'll give you as my parting gift, as DG Customs."
Uh-huh.
Give them license. Give them license. One man who is now governor in Jigawa or some other place, give them a warehouse and give them 600 million there.
Wow.
At a point in time, that terminal, you can go there and see 200 containers, 2,000 containers even. Just listen, the ministry of the gospel is one business you can enter without capital.
Yeah.
You don't need no capital.
Yeah.
The Word of God is sufficient capital. I have tasted of the mercies of God.
Hallelujah.
You know, that's why when I sit quietly like this, I don't know what anybody will say that is extraordinary. So we have come a long way. I took time to mention the people I've served. I started from Scripture Union 1974 March. Been part of Church of God Mission, been part of Assemblies of God AG. Somehow Equa. Somehow I came into the Pentecostal movement, Household, Revival Assembly, World Missions Outreach, Glory Land, Christian National Faith Ministry. The only church I've never really had any brush with is Redeem, because Redeem is new. I remember when they were talking about one church in cinema hall, you know. So, I think we have come a long way, really.
Yeah. Okay, sir. Thank you so much, sir. Another question for you, sir.
Looks like I answered the other one for too long.
I have you saying that you've been moving your church.
Exodus, yeah.
So,
the church in the wilderness.
Yeah, so the question is, how have you been coping about your members? How have you been coping from moving from one place to another?
It's crazy. I'm sorry about that expression, but it's crazy, really. Because once you move, you start afresh again.
Mm.
Because these are days where church members go for convenience.
Mm-hmm.
I don't have that background, but that is the reality today. I remember when I was in secondary school that we used to, because I gave my life to Christ in class 2 in secondary school.
Wow.
Yes. But between my primary school and that class 2, where we live, I'm from my father was just an artisan, a painter for the PWD. So I grew up, no privileges. I talk about it, and I like talking about it even. So we lived in a compound, you know, this is not face me, I face you really, but it's almost that. So they sell Indian hemp in that house. So we, the young boys, were the people they were using to cut that piece of paper like this.
Yeah.
So they gathered us together, we'll be cutting that paper, packing the Indian hemp for the smokers, rolling it. But today, I don't know what it tastes like. Never come near me, and I will roll it for them. So my experience from that is, I saw professors come from the university to that our area to smoke in their hemp. So I used to ask, if a professor can come into this small cubicle used with waterproof to cover the room, why can't we look for Jesus in Agege if we can find him there? So this rubbish of my church must be in the center of the city. It's crazy, man. I don't understand it. Personally, I mean, I'm not speaking for the people, I know myself. What you're looking for, where it is, you go there. If you're serious.
That's right.
That's my attitude.
All right. The last question now.
I don't know if it answered the question of where we are.
Yes, it does. Yes, it
does. So we just start afresh. God has helped me that starting church no longer is hard for me. I start clapping. You know that our issue.
Yeah.
Then those who when you are denkpa, that I need you to put in angles.
Okay, sir. So one more question, just the last question before we allow our papa to be. Another question is, sir. What advice would you give to, because these days we find out that some young men are not ready to serve. They are not ready to serve. They just want to go into the ministry and start making money. Even when God has not called them, they call themselves. So what advice do you give to them out there?
Well, that one is very easy and very simple. One, are they looking for advice? Looking for advice. So troubling them with your advice is a waste of time. Why? Because they know what they are looking for. You said they want to go and start making money. So what are you advising him? He knows what he wants. And he's going for it. Is it not somebody who doesn't know, say, Ben, how should I go that you advise? This man has made up his mind what he's looking for, and he knows it and he's going for it. So there's no room for advice. So what I do is to sometimes when I look at things, I'll just explode and start pouring words of my mind to myself. Whether anybody wants to listen or not, I don't care. Two, the wrongest place to look for money is in the church.
Mm-hmm.
If I am determined to make money, I know what to do. Look at me from head to toe. Do you think I don't know how to make money? What? I know. I can become a billionaire. Look at Kubana Adem that graduated in 1990 when I was already living in a duplex in the Ajawa Estate. I was one of the first people who had a digital telephone line in Lagos. Tell you. When all the 419 people were looking for a telephone line, I had a fax machine. I was getting letters from Brazil, all these oil companies that they are interested in Nigeria's oil on my fax machine. Listen, there was once, I was a pastor, and telecommunication consultants of India were bringing in cables into Nigeria, and they asked me to bring in cables for them from Japan. 70 containers of armored cable, with which they did the Lagos backbone for telecommunications. This is inside the water. I brought them in. It was worth $4 million. 1996. That was the year I started this church. $4 million. I brought it in. If you go to Allied Bank in Lagos, then Allied Bank was stopped. Whenever they see me, they see that Abiola has come again. So the kind of cash. You know why I'm saying this? Okay. If you go into church to make money, who will give you the money? Somebody's tithe is it zero? Somebody is sweating and bringing a tenth of his life. You know your money is your sweat.
Yeah.
It's your blood. Somebody has sweated and they brought a tenth of it to church. Is that what you're going to be using to go to hotel? To go and drive motor? Won't God to kill you? Or you think God is not real? So that's not money. That's not money. It's blood. So if you are looking for money, forget church. Go do what the guys are doing. Make money. But here, my experience is that the Bible says that man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word. I was asking God, he said to me, because I said, God, what shall I and my family eat? He said, you eat Jesus. So how does a man eat Jesus? I learned it the most. How to eat Jesus and be sustained. The way God has provided for me things I need is strange. The word of God has capacity to create bread, but bread cannot create matter.
Yeah.
You understand? I was traveling to America, stopped by in the UK, and the Cameroonian doctor had inspected some girls, and the girl said that he didn't have gloves. So they reported him to the British authorities that he was in court, facing judgment. Two white girls. My brother, who was a doctor there, too, told me, I said, go and bring him, brought him. I said, I hear that you have problems with the British authorities. He said, yes. Did you do it? He said, no. Are you sure? He said, yes. I said, okay. Go and bring money, let me pray for you. Bring money. I'm going to ask you to stand on your money, let me pray. He said, I have not been on salary for 6 months. I said, go then, you and stay with your problem. Is he not who has a problem?
Mm.
So he went back to North London. I was in the South. He went to North London, Edmonton, and brought, I've never seen such a number of coins in my life. Excess luggage. Coins, not notes. He said, this is where himself and his wife brought any coin in the house. He brought it in and he stood on that. And I poured the whole anointing oil on his head, finished it. I don't know why I poured it that way. Even me myself, I don't know. When I finished, I had coins there. One pound, only God knows how many there were. If you carry it in your luggage, police will arrest you. It's excess luggage. Meanwhile, when I left Nigeria, I didn't have half a pound. God just told me to go to America, pack my things, enter the craft, on a route, US. And came to London where this thing happened. So all of the pounds I had, I couldn't even carry a pound to America. I left them there and continued it. once I minister, I used to preach for Wusen, Obadare, in Maryland. You know the way they did this year? That's how Wusen is, in the whole of Maryland, Washington area. Once I arrive and Dr. Joe, his son, hears I'm in town, they invite me. I prepare for revival for the big man to come. After preparing for revival, food will be coming like this. Food everywhere. Some people are touching my clothes. One of them, let me just touch this clothes. Just give me $100. This one, give me $20. We carry dollars all up and down. They carried me from there into American Defense Headquarters in Pentagon. God opened the door. Did I enter Pentagon? I said, this is the headquarters of United States military. If you see that place, there are soldiers in U.S. Army who have never been in Pentagon. They don't know where it is. When I got to that place, I lifted up my Bible like this. I said, oh God, this, I don't know where I'm going. I put my Bible on my head. Do you know where that place is? The kind of soldiers I saw. I saw a soldier that was 7 feet. The kind of equipment. In fact, when you look at the roof, you see people's eye. Because you don't know that there, 24 hours shift. Eye like this. I enter there, meet all those young girls, young guys going to Iraq those days. I said, Bishop, please pray for me. I'm going to Iraq. I'd like to come back. Let me sow into your life. This is what they will be putting money into my pocket. I was preaching in the office of the chaplain in Pentagon. I said, America, your confidence is too much. God is going to discipline you. Next week after I left was 9/11. My phones were jammed. Bishop Oscar, remember what you said that day? Wow! You're a man of God. But I'm not. I'm just a simple Bible believing, God trusting person. I don't even know if I have gifts or not. All I know is that I have seen the message of God. And I know that nobody that trusts God is ever put to shame.
Yeah.
That doesn't mean I'm perfect. God forbid, perfect care. But I said, God, this morning I went to pray very early. I said, God, I'm that prodigal son. He said, as many as come to you, you will not cast out for enemies. Doesn't matter how bad. So, man, can I tell you? Anybody who is looking for money and is deceiving himself and the people, wait for the judgment of God. God is coming. It's not about money. It's about life. It's about life. I mean, I don't want to stop preaching as well.
Yeah, thank you so much.
Thank you so much, sir.